आई कैन हियर।
ओके ओके
ओके
सर। द चीफ पैट्रोन ऑफ द प्रोग्राम, चेयरमैन ऑफ टुडेज सेशन, प्रोफेसर सोमनाथ दत्ता, डीन महात्मा गांधी स्कूल ऑफ इकोनॉमिक्स एंड कॉमर्स एंड फॉर्मर डीन ऑफ स्वामी विवेकानंद स्कूल ऑफ लाइब्रेरी साइंसेज एंड DSR स्कूल ऑफ लीगल स्टडीज एंड हेड ऑफ द डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ इकोनॉमिक्स आसाम यूनिवर्सिटी सिलचर। ऑल द इन्वाइटेड स्पीकर डॉक्टर प्रिया राय यूनिवर्सिटी लाइब्रेरियन नेशनल लॉ यूनिवर्सिटी न्यू दिल्ली, डॉक्टर बी संजय यूनिवर्सिटी लाइब्रेरियन त्रिपुरा यूनिवर्सिटी अगरतला, डॉक्टर आकाश सिंह असिस्टेंट लाइब्रेरियन स्टेज टू नेशनल लॉ यूनिवर्सिटी न्यू दिल्ली, डॉक्टर अनुपम चंद्रा लाइब्रेरियन डॉन बॉस्को यूनिवर्सिटी गुवाहाटी। ऑल अदर इन्वाइटेड स्पीकर्स अटेंडिंग दिस लेक्चर प्रोग्राम, ऑल द डीन्स ऑफ स्कूल, हेड ऑफ द डिपार्टमेंट, ऑल स्टेचुटरी ऑफिसर्स, अदर ऑफिसर्स एंड स्टाफ ऑफ आसाम यूनिवर्सिटी सिलचर, ऑल द कमिटी मेंबर्स, डॉक्टर अंशुमान सेन डायरेक्टर कंप्यूटर सेंटर एंड को कन्वीनर ऑफ द प्रोग्राम, डॉक्टर मुकुट शर्मा एसोसिएट प्रोफेसर एंड ज्वाइंट ऑर्गेनाइजिंग सेक्रेटरी, डॉक्टर मिसेस सुमना चक्रवर्ती शर्मा डेपुटी लाइब्रेरियन एंड ज्वाइंट ऑर्गेनाइजिंग सेक्रेटरी, डॉक्टर नवीन चंद्र दे असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर एंड रिपोर्टियर जनरल, ऑल द असिस्टेंट ऑर्गेनाइजिंग सेक्रेटरीज, श्री राजेश रंगपाल डारथी असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर, डॉक्टर अपूर्वा ज्योति मजुमदार असिस्टेंट लाइब्रेरियन, श्री अमित उराव असिस्टेंट लाइब्रेरियन एंड श्री कल्लोल दास तालुकदार इंफॉर्मेशन साइंटिस्ट, फ्रॉम रविंद्र लाइब्रेरी एंड टेक्निकल सपोर्ट टीम मेंबर श्री मंजीत सिंघा मास्टर मिस्टर तुषार सिन्हा एंड अभिषेक सिन्हा एंड ऑल द स्पीकर एंड वैल्यूबल पार्टिसिपेंट रिसर्च स्कॉलर एंड स्टूडेंट। इट इज ए ग्रेट मोमेंट फॉर ऑल ऑफ अस दैट वी आर ऑर्गेनाइजिंग दिस इवेंट टू सेलिब्रेट वीक लॉन्ग प्रोग्राम ऑन द ईव ऑफ नेशनल लाइब्रेरियन डे सेलिब्रेशन। दिस प्रोग्राम कंप्राइजेज ऑफ lectures on various aspects of research methodology and role of emerging technologies in managing libraries, online teaching learning and research during this pandemic period. I feel pleasure in welcoming all of you in this program, which is being organized during 8 to 14 August 2020. On behalf of the Department of Library and Information Science under Swami Vivekananda School of Library Sciences and Ravindra and organizing committee and on my personal behalf, I, Professor Manoj Kumar Sinha, welcome our Honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor Dilip Chandra Nath, Chief Patron of the event, who has been constant source of inspiration for all of us. He has motivated and encouraged all of us to organize online webinar during this lockdown period. Many departments have taken initiatives and we from department and Ravindra Library decided to organize this week-long program on the eve of Librarians Day celebration. I also welcome our chairman of the session, Professor Sumnas Datta, Dean Mahatma Gandhi School of Economics and Commerce and former Dean of Swami Vivekananda School of Library and Information Science and DSR School of Legal Studies and head of the Department of Economics, Assam University Silchar, for accepting our request to grace the occasion as the chairman of the session on day 6 lecture program. I also welcome invited speaker Dr. Priya Rai, University Librarian, National Law University, New Delhi, Dr. B. Sanjay, University Librarian, Tripura University, Agartala, Dr. Akash Singh, Assistant Librarian, Stage 2, National Law University, New Delhi, and our research scholar, Dr. Anupam Chanda, librarian, Don Bosco University, Guwahati, for accepting our proposal to deliver invited lecture in this event. Finally, I welcome all the deans of school, HOD, all officers, team members, staff, research scholars, students, ladies and gentlemen who are connected with us through YouTube channel, and our most valuable participants in this 1 week long online lecture program. So with this, I welcome you all of you in this program. So format of the lecture program will be that After introduction by Dr. Sumna Chakravarti Sharma, our chairman sir will take over the session and conduct the session. And at the end of the session, Sri Amit Rao will take up question answer session and offer vote of thanks. Now I request Dr. Sumna Chakravarti Sharma, Deputy Librarian, Ravindra Library and Joint Organizing Secretary of the event, to briefly introduce our invited chairman and speakers of the event. Thanks, Dr. Sumna Chakravarti Sharma. Please, you may start introducing our guest.
Thank you, sir. Am I audible, sir?
Yes.
Yeah. So thank you. Honorable Vice Chancellor, Chief Patron of the program, Professor Dilip
Chandra. You can on your camera. All speakers may on their camera.
Is it okay now? Hello?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. So, Honorable Vice Chancellor, Chief Patron of the program, Professor Dilip Chandranath, respected Head of the Department, Dean, Department of Library and Information Science, also the Acting Librarian, Ravindra Library, Assam University, Chairman and Convener of the program, Professor M.K. Sinha, respected Dean, HOD, Department of Economics, Assam University, Sumana Zattasar, who will session this chair, who will chair this session of the today's program, respected Director, Computer Center and Co-Convener of the program, Dr. Anshuman Sen, respected Dr. Mukut Sharma, Associate Professor, Department of Library and Information Science, Assam University, and Joint Organizing Secretary of the program, and all other organizing committee members and participants. It's my privilege to be a part of the program and introduce the speakers. First of all, I'd like to introduce our beloved Sir, Dean, and HOD, Department of Economics, though we all know him very well, Professor Sumana Zattasar, who will chair today's session. Sir has 36 years of teaching experience of working as head, Dean, Finance Officer in two universities, Assam University and TU. His area of specialization, Development Economics, Population Studies and Economics of Education. His research activities include 24 PhD and MPhil completed near about 80 publications of research articles and 3 books. Now I'd like to say a few lines about our invited speaker, Dr. PRI. She is serving as Deputy Librarian and Officer in Charge of Justice TPS Chawla Library at National Law University, Delhi. She has experience of more than 20 years of active library services with various renowned universities and research institutional libraries. She has rendered her service with university libraries, namely Guru Gobind Singh Indraprastha University and Indian Law Institute. Dr. Rai earned her BSc from Delhi University. She has obtained PhD in Library and Information Science from Vanasthali University, Rajasthan. She is a law graduate and pulled in LLM in Special Interest on Intellectual Property Rights from Guru Gobind Singh Indraprastha University, New Delhi. Dr. Priya is a Commonwealth Professional Fellow, IALS, University of London. She is also a Visiting Law Library Fellow, Institute of Advanced Legal Studies, London. She is the recipient of FCIL Schaeffer Grant from American Association of Law Libraries 2012 and Wittner Research Fellowship from Cornell University Law Library, USA. She also delivered a talk on 105th Annual Meeting and Conference, AALA, Boston. She has credited organizing more than 5 international and national conferences on various themes, including copyrights, digital licensing, artificial intelligence, and open access to law movement, MOOCs, academic publishing, and research. She has co-edited 7 books and published more than 35 papers in referred journals and conference proceedings. Dr. Priya has According with development of more than 12 MOOCs modules for EPG Pathshala, UGC, SWAYAM and NEOS platform. She is associated with Legal Information Institute of India project. She is associated with Special Library Association, Indian Library Association, Delhi Library Association and All India Media Library Association. Our next speaker, Dr. B. Sanjay, is working as a librarian in Tripura University since December 2016. Earlier, he was associated with a software company, Infosys Limited, as a lead librarian for almost 20 years. He is a science graduate and was awarded the PhD degree for the title An Analysis of Database Activities and Its Impact on University Libraries of Karnataka, a Critical Study from Karnataka University, Dharwar, in the year 2015. He has published more than 15 articles in journals, international conferences and seminars. He has organized and attended many conferences, seminars and workshops in various capacities with the collaboration of different organizations. He received Best Librarian Award for the year 2019 from Karnataka State Government through Department of Public Library on November 18, 2019. He is a member of various national and international library associations. He was part of SLA editorial committee in the year 2009. He received Excellence Team Award in 2003 conferred by Infosys Limited to the education and research team in recognition of outstanding achievement in the field of people development. He received the award for the contribution made towards Infosys Campus Connect program during the year 2007-8. Next, our invited speaker, Dr. Akash Singh. He is currently serving to National Law University with capacity of Assistant Librarian, Law and Legal Services at its Justice TPS Chawla Library. Dr. Singh is associated with National Law University since October 2009. He has experienced more than 16 years of service in different library of reputed academic institutions. Prior to his present assignment, Dr. Akash Singh worked with Indian Law Institute, Kendra Vidyalaya and IITM Delhi. Dr. Akash has obtained BCom, MA, BLIC, MPhil, LISC and Postgraduate Diploma in Library Automation and Networking. Dr. Singh has obtained his doctorate from Vikram University, Ujjain on Public Domain Legal Resources. He is also a law graduate and has earned LLB degree. Dr. Singh was awarded Best Young Law Librarian Award instituted by Association of Indian Law Libraries, instituted by Manu Patra in September 2009, which was conferred in International Conference on Digital Transformation at RG Annual, Patiala, India. He was awarded International Law Librarian International Bursaries attending annual course of international law from International Association of Law Libraries at Barcelona, Spain in 2013. Dr. Akash has been awarded Best Paper Award at ICOL 2017 and Digital 2019. He has credited 7 edited books and 31 articles in peer-reviewed journals and conferences. He has specialization in online reference services, free access to law movement, and digitization. He is a member of many library associations like AILL, ILA, IALL, SLA, AIMLA, IVF for serving community libraries in Delhi. So that's all about our today's speakers. Now I'd like to request Professor M.K. Sinha to continue the.
Dr. Chakravarti, please introduce Dr. Anup Chanda. I have
okay.
Sent details.
Yeah. Anupam Chanda, he is our beloved student of Department of Library Information Science of Assam University. He was our student earlier, but now he is working as a librarian in Don Bosco University, Guwahati. And he has special, ability to do many solve many problems in FOHA. He has special he has taken this as a special action. So I don't have any other information about it, but it's a good, very good fellow who is very active in our subject. That's it. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. for introducing our speaker. Now I request our respected Professor Sunna Datta sir to take up the session with a request that Dr. B. Sanjay, he want to present first due to some urgent work. So I would like to request you kindly invite him first, then as per sequence. So Professor Sunna Datta, over to you, please.
Okay, Professor Sinha, it is my privilege. Dr. B. Sanjay, Librarian, Tripura University, to deliver his in this session.
Thank you, sir. Dr. B. Sanjay, are you able to upload your PPT?
Dr. B. Sanjay, are you able to upload your?
Or should I upload?
No, I am trying, sir. One
okay.
Second.
Okay. It is coming, yes. You can do slides, so sir.
Just a minute. There is some technical problem.
Okay.
Sina sir, is it possible for you to share my PPT? I'm facing some problem here. Hello?
Your PPT has already come on the screen.
No, but I am having problem in sharing the PPT. Some software glitch.
Okay, sir. Okay.
Can you just, no?
Now you can see the PPT, sir?
Yeah, I can see the PPT.
Okay, you may start now.
Okay, sir. Good morning, everybody. First, I would like to thank Assam University for providing me this opportunity. And Professor M.D. Sinha, when he requested, I was very much delighted to join this, you know, the team of the expert panel. And today I am very much honored with the presence of Professor Sumanshu Datta, the Dean of Assam University. So under his chairmanship, I would like to deliver the presentation here. And also I would like to thank all the experts in the sessions and also the other scholars and the participants who are with me today for giving me this opportunity for sharing some thoughts on the digital library services. With my small acquaintance with the library and library services, Today, I would like to highlight on some of the facts during this the pandemic scenario, how we can take up the library for the next course of delivering of the services. Dear friends, sir, can you please move to the next slide? Or can you please give me the control of the session? Today, when we are in the sad situation, pandemic situation, when we are having 143 countries also already closed down, and the world's biggest libraries like New York Public Libraries closed their operations. And many of our professionals, they are a little bit confused about the quarantine period of print materials. So when we are able to get our the daily newspapers, and when we are able to get our the print books to the library, the question and we need to be asked why we are not able to open the library for the general use. So that was the confusion among our library professional. And I am very sad to say that even our library association, even the renowned association like IFLA and the ALE also, not putting up the proper guidelines on how we can take up this, or what would be the situation after the unlock, and what are the, you know, the operation we will have to conduct. Even in Indian scenario also, the much of the library associations are concentrated on the conducting the webinar and some of the, you know, the guidance and training. But many of us, we are not able to see that what kind of, you know, the operations the library will have to take up during this the lockdown period, or during this unlocking period. And also, many of our professionals, they are not having a common consensus on what kind of, you know, the operations to be rolled out, or what kind of, and we are talking more on the digital library services and what will happen to the print the collection, or what will happen to the print the services. So are we going only with the digital services, or we are also going parallelly with the print services? Sina sir, next slide. When we are talking about the library, are we talking only the physical space, or are we talking about the digital spaces? What we are actually talking when we are talking about the library? So are we talking about the building? Are we talking about the collection? Or the staff, the library staff, or the kind of services what we are rolling out? So what is actually the library? We will have to figure out what is actually important in the library, and what kind of the services are important, and what to be prioritized in the, you know, the situation like the disaster situation like this in the pandemic scenario. What kind of the services we will have to take it on priority, and what is our the core objective of the library? So we will have to decide on that. Then it will be easy for us to take up the new role of the library, or it is easy for us to switch to from the traditional operation to digital operations. Sir, next slide. So when we are seeing the industry, the various industry, they have disrupted and they have taken new shape. Like if you say take the, you know, the transport industry or taxi, the services, the Uber and the Ola has given a new way of the services. They don't have to own any of the vehicles, but still they are operational. Like in the facility in the industry, like Airbnb founded August 20, 2008. So they don't have any hotel, but still they are in a, you know, the hotel industry or the facilities, you know, the industry. And we all are familiar with the Coursera, and nowadays we are familiar with our own the portal, the Swayam. So they have given a kind of a new space for digital learning, or the off-campus learning. And when we see the retail industry also going forward a big change, like Amazon Go is introducing new kind of, you know, the retail shops. And also the Zomato, the food industry is changing, and food supply chain is changing. So everywhere we are seeing the disruption in the industry, and also it is giving a new path to the services. So where we are and what kind of, you know, the disruption we are expecting, and this is the right moment we have to think on the disruption instead of, you know, telling every time that the library is going to extinct and the library is going to be no more operational. So we will have to think the new way of the services. Sina sir, next slide. When we go for the digital trend around the world, so how many of the population really are the using the digital technology? Like if you see 5.19 billion of the users are using the mobile, in that 4.54 billion are having access to internet, and the active social media users are 3.80. So if you see the digital trend in India, sir, next slide. So in India, so what kind of, you know, the digital trend we are seeing? Like, so most of the people are, you know, they settled in watching the videos, and they, you know, are interested in the listening to the music or podcast, or so they are not thinking about how they can access online or how they can use the digital content for the education space. So when we are thinking all this, so where the library comes and what kind of the library we are expecting? So in the recent, sir, next slide. So in our recent survey, when we see the Pew industry, they have conducted a survey. In that, so some of the, you know, the expectation people were expecting from the library. So what kind of the expectation the people are having about the library is also important to provide effective services. Like the people are expecting kind of the information and digital literacy. So what kind of the information materials are available across the world, and how to use the digital material? These are the expectation from the general public in the public libraries. Like people are expecting the content creation and the distribution. Like when we are talking about the digital, the material, and it is very important for us to see that most of the young people are digital native. What is digital native? So they are not seen actually the print material. So whatever the accessing the information, the pattern is digital itself. So they are not accessing a traditional way of information through print media. So their accessing of information itself is from the digital. So we don't see all of our print material available in a digital space. Who will have to create this print material into digital? So the librarian will come to picture, and he will have to take up the new role. Like the people are very much interested on the various kind of policy rolled out by the government, or rolled out by the local community, or rolled out by the local administration. And also the people are expecting a kind of the skill development or the training programs from the library, so that they can attend these kind of the skill development programs or training, and they can take up for the new venture. Then the people, obviously, they are expecting kind of the digital demo space. Like any kind of a new digital material or gadget come into market, so people are very much interested to see those and feel the touch, they experience it in a library, so that they can use it effectively. And also the library main portion is the community space. It will have to arrange various kind of interaction in the library. So these are the kind of the expectation from the library. Sir, next slide.
Sir, control already given. You can move your slide.
Yes. So now Yeah. So why the library? When we are talking about the expectation from the library, and why only library? Library is known as a trusted place. So any information comes through library, people easily can trust that information, and it's a kind of a authentic information. And librarians are known as experts in organizing and curation of knowledge. So they know different methodology, or they know different technique to organize and curate the library. Then library obviously is a friendly environment. So they feel very comfortable talking to the librarians. Then it is very easy to adopt robust and long lost technology. So whatever the technology offered by the library is user friendly, and it's a robust, and so they don't frequently change. Then transparency in the process, like whatever the books they acquire, or whatever the information they provide, or whatever the kind of the services library providing, is a kind of the transparent process they follow, and it is very easy for people to believe and trust this information. Like in the library, people, the other main reason come to the library is it is a affordable and cost effective services. And obviously people expect the unbiased and ethical kind of the behavior from the library staff. So how the traditional and digitals are changing? Like the traditional libraries are more oriented on collection of contents, but in the digital space, it's more on creation of the contents. It is a user specific. The traditional the libraries were providing deep reading the facilities, but in the digital, it is always the quick browsing facility. In a traditional method, we are having a restricted media. It is either if we are going with the visual media, it's a visual media. If we are going with the print media, it's a only print media. And in a digital space, they are having options of multimedia. And the most of the traditional libraries are offering a general collection. It might not be a specific, or it not be an individualistic approach, but in a digital space, it's a very specific the information they are able to get from the library. Now, what is that the new role the librarian will have to play? He will have to engage with the users. Constantly, he will have to connect with the user on the requirement. Like, he will have to assess the content and create the content. And also, he will have to arrange a scholarly communication and a total the ecosystem. It is a kind of the knowledge exchange ecosystem he will have to create. And he will have to analyze the various data in the library to come to conclusion. And also the integration of learning system. He should be aware of the various technology to integrate the learning systems, and also visibility and branding he will have to create in the library. So he should be a creative, he should be excellent communicator, he should be tech savvy, he should be a negotiator, and he should be a learner. And also, he should be a manager. So, this kind of the background, what kind of the services the different libraries can offer to their users? If you look at the school libraries, the school libraries in this pandemic situation is taking the new role, and many of the the schools are rolled out all the already online classes. And also, what is the role of the library, especially the school going children? We will have to see that many of the public library, they found it very easy to switch over to the digital space. Whatever the programs they were conducting earlier in a traditional library, so they just moved those programs to the digital space. Like if we see a Peterstown, the library, public library in the US, they have formed kind of a digital escape room. It can be called as the treasure hunt program, or it can be kind of the activity, like identification of the resources and moving on to the different kind of the reading arena. So they have brought out this kind of the program for the children to develop interest in the reading. And in a British Council library, they are offering reading challenge. They are giving a set of books to the children, and they are actually asking them to read. And finally, they are asking them to write a review on those books. So it will create an interest in the students about the reading material. And also they are offering the various kind of the stories telling session. And also they are bringing out the magazine, the collaborative magazine. Like they are involving the students itself in the magazine development process. And also they are conducting various arts and crafts workshop for the school going children. So there, the librarians are engaging the students in a digital space, so that the students will not be isolated, and they are engaged in the reading because they are away from the formal classes. Now, when we talk about the services in college and university library, so here we need different set of the library service and different set of the library skills. Now, what is the students they are expecting? They will have to undergo the various competitive exams. They will have to undertake. So they should be made ready for taking this kind of the exams. And also they will have to develop a various kind of skill development programs. Like in British Library, they are arranging the English language improving classes. Likewise, the various college libraries can take up this kind of the services, skill development program for the students. And so they can make the students take part in the the quiz program, or the kind of like even in our library, sometimes we have conducted the online preparatory exam for the NET or SET coaching. So likewise, we can have various kind of services for the skill development. And the distance learning, so since now SWAYAM is there, or MOOC courses are there. So only thing is we will have to identify which courses are suitable for our students, and we have to make the arrangement with the administrators to make the use of these courses in the distance mode, and the students can enroll to these courses, and they can complete the courses which is available in their syllabus. And also they can the librarians can arrange the collaboration and collaborative research. Like they can integrate the 2-3 departments, and they can integrate even the local community also, and what kind of the research they can offer for the local community or in the local space, that they can arrange. And the flip learning is a new concept. It is coming up now. Before attending the classes, the students are supposed to learn about the material or learn about the content of the courses where they are going to attend. So the flip learning is a kind of the platform where it is preparing the students for attending their formal the classes, so that in the classes the teachers, they don't waste the time, simply they can interact with the students. So in the online classes, what happened now, in the earlier classroom sessions, the teachers were trained to give a class notes and all. But now what we can do is the online classes we can mainly reserve for the discussion and interaction, and all the supportive materials earlier appear to the classes itself, we can supply to the students. Like we can arrange a digital literacy program also. So we can arrange a various kind of orientation program for students, like so how to use the plagiarism check software, how to use the online databases, or how to use the Scopus or the data analytical tool, how to use the statistical software. These kind of the services library can take up in the college and university. Sir, I think I am not able to move. Can I just move to the next slide?
Yes.
Our National Digital Library of India, which is very active in the recent days. So they are offering various kind of the services. It has started in the year 2018. So they are offering various kind of the services. They are providing the full text of the material, and also through this, the NDLI, we can see what are the courses conducted by the different institutes. So we can easily integrate this with our Swayam or the Swayam Prabha channels.
You can move, sir.
In research library, the requirement is something unique. Like in the very recent the pandemic period, the many researchers are interested in the articles or the artifacts on COVID-19. Like some of the examples we have, like kind of the services in the Malaysian university, they have provided kind of a evidence retrieval service. Like whatever the artifacts available on the COVID-19 research, they were able to collect everything and they were able to distribute to their the user community. So we can see that what kind of the researchers are happening in the university or research happening in the the research center. Accordingly, we can either arrange a document delivery services on request. The kind of we can tie up with one or more institutes. Even in our consortia, like in our InfliPNet consortia, eSocindo, they are providing this kind of facility. We can ask the document delivery services through one of the institutes where we have a tie-up or who is also our consortia partner. Also, we can have some vendors who are dedicated in documental delivery services. They will provide the service against some cost. Then we can also connect the experts. Very recently in the InfliPNet, they are rolling out a new portal that is called InFeed, where the Vidya Mitra or Vidwan, those portals actually connecting the experts. They are talking about the experts, and we can easily connect to those experts and talk about our the research topic or interested the field. Then also research support, so we can talk to our research scholars or the researcher on various kind of the research management tools, like the Mendeley, EndNote, or any of the recent tools available, like digital common tools. Or we can also tell them about their our own institutional repositories, and also we can tell them how to analyze the result from the corpus, like how to do the citation analysis, how to do the literature search services. These kind of the services, either we can create a kind of the groups through email or through WhatsApp or through any of the social media platform, and we can interact or we can engage the researcher in these kind of these services. The requirement of the service in rural or the community libraries are different. Very recently we have seen the migration from the cities to the rural. So what kind of these migrants require the services they require? Like if any the refugees or any person with the disabilities or a kind of the agriculture the farmer or any of the a particular group how they can get the services. One thing is we can enable a group member, any of the group members, to capture their own, you know, the best practices and roll out to their community itself, and we can arrange the kind of a discussion in the community. So we can arrange a kind of a small kind of the you can say that you can say a cult or kind of the digital the group where they can come together and they can discuss about the problems of the community or the kind of the services. We can also arrange a kind of the interaction within the group so that they can within the group itself they can talk and they can solve their own problems. Now in the urban city libraries the requirement is the different, the general public, like if you see our the very recent the activities in the Delhi government, they have one community library. They have started kind of the program Duniya Sabki. That means they read aloud programs where actually they are taking some Hindi books or they can taking some English books and they are reading aloud. We may require some corporate permission for this kind of services, but still we can talk to the publisher or we can talk to a particular the owners of the books and we can start arranging this kind of the services. We can also set up a various the language lab where the people can learn different languages, and also reader advisors are like the different group of the people, how they can access to the different the kind of the novels or the books or what kind of the books they can read or what kind of the information resources available, whether it's a primary, whether it's a secondary or tertiary. So we can introduce them about the various kind of the resources available in a public domain, and we can encourage them to use these kind of the resources. In our Karnataka government, they have rolled out the e-Sarvajanika Granthalaya, where actually they have put the lot of the digital books in the digital portal, and they are encouraging people to access this portal. In New York, the public library, they have arranged a brain fuse. Brain fuse means it's a we are nowadays having a the program called Cult also, where actually the people, the one-to-one, the tutorial classes can be arranged, or a set of the people can come together, and if they are interested to learn anything, so we can arrange a kind of the expert to teach them on those kind of the subjects or those kind of the skills. Also, we can start some the podcast services about our local community, or kind of the reading of the few pages of the book. So we can also form the online book club, and many of the libraries are starting the storytelling session also. So there are a lot of the ways to reach out to the users in the digital community. In business library, again, the expectation is different in the business library. I'm talking about the corporate libraries or the company libraries or the libraries where they have attached to the company. So they there actually we have to tie up with a different kind of vendor for the newspaper reading or the data services or kind of the online the content or the video material. Like the Harvard the university is providing Harvard management solution for the soft skills program. So we will have to tie up with the various kind of the content providers and make it available to the readers. And also within the organization, we will have to set up various kind of the knowledge the related the portals, like it might be the wikis, the you know the wikis of some groups or the discussion the groups or the expert groups. So we can have this kind of the information available in a portal itself, and also we will have to provide various kind of services in the business, like packing of the information. Like there are pre-sale services for the customers or the marketing group or the product the support group. So these people may require kind of the information package specific to a company or specific to subject or a specific to the functionality of the group. Also, in the corporate library, it is very important to work on the return on investment, like how much we are spending on each of the item and how much in return we are getting. Also, the corporate libraries are expecting a tie-up with the institution or individual in a kind of the collaboration in providing the content. So these kind of the services we can enable either through our local library services or the different the academic institutional services. In archives and museum library, the functionality is very different. They will have to concentrate on digitization and preservation. The digitization of the traditional knowledge and the preservation of these materials, like it might be a manuscript or it might be a case of the stone tablets or the artifacts, whatever it may be. So it should be available in a kind of the digital platform, so people can easily access those things. So one of the examples in the pandemic situation, Library Congress, they have organized a kind of a service called the virtual transcribathon. So this actually, the museum, they take out a artifact and display in a digital media, and they will get the various the crowdsourcing the information on the artifacts, and they compile and make it available in a kind of the digital book format or in a kind of in a digital the audio or video the format. So these kind of services can be taken by the museum library. And also,
if you are remembering,
Dr. Sanjay Sol, can you hear me? Chairman speaking.
Yes, sir. I am able to hear
you. Sir.
Yeah, please. There is some time call. You have urgent work to attend. That's why, please.
Sir, I will finish. I'll just finish. This is. And if you remember the Spanish flu, what kind of the situation was there in the Spanish flu, we were not aware. So if we collect at least now the COVID-19 situation and make it available for the future generation, it will be very useful. And I will not take much of the time on the technology. So these are all some of the technology, drones and the digital interface media, and also the print on demand machines and 3D printers, so how they are used in the libraries, and also the augmented reality, like these are the services in a digitally we can provide to the people to search the books within the library through a online portal. Features and some challenge we have: changing technology, investment on resources, and we have to maintain the DRM, digital privacy, the income inequality, and some of the racial disparity or local ignorance. So when we are going with the flat world, so we may tend to ignore some of the the local information. We have to take care of these things. So with this, I am very much thankful to you all for providing this opportunity. I hope I could deliver some of the useful information to you. Thank you. Sir, I am done. You can take up.
Sir, you may request another speaker to start. Chairman sir, can you listen me?
Yeah. Yes.
You may request. Okay.
Okay.
Another speaker. Sir Priya Rai.
Priya Rai. Second speaker.
You may request.
Please invite her. And how much time is for her speech?
Sir, 35 minutes you can give.
Okay, please invite her. I'm delighted to invite Dr. Priya Rai, Law University, New Delhi, to please deliver your speech.
He's trying to connect. Madam, you can start. Your voice is not coming, madam. Sir, unmute karo unko.
Am I audible?
Yes, yes, ma'am.
Okay, thank you. I'll just share my screen. Is my screen visible, sir?
Yes.
Okay, sir. So I'll start my presentation. First of all, most respected Professor M.K. Sinha, sir, chair of the session, Professor Datta, sir, thank you so much for giving me this opportunity to have a words with the wonderful listeners who have joined us today in the early morning on a very important topic, which is intellectual property right and copyright in technological world, issues and concern.
Ma'am, PPT, yes, now it is coming. Yes,
yes, sir. So I would like to thank Department of Library Information Science, Swami Vivekanand School of Library Science and Rabindra Library, Assam University, Silchar. So thank you, Professor M.K. Sinha, sir, for giving me this opportunity to have a short kind of discussion and deliberation about a very important topic of today's scenario, where technology is everywhere, as said by Dr. Sanjay sir, the age of disruption. This is an age of disruption, and we can say a phase of global innovation with gradual technology accelerating digital literature content by scholars and organization. But I can also say that thus this precept of this revolutionary development in access to dissemination of information flow has already been jumped towards highly integrated system, we can say, of information preservation and dissemination. This is really very important. But the big question which comes in front of us is legal and policy, especially the legal and policy creators, that how to harmonize and maintain perfect balance with copyright creators and users of the information. This is really very important. Where is the perfect balance with, whereas we, the, to maintain this perfect balance, various tools have been generated, kind of creative common licenses. There is a boom in licenses nowadays in digital world, and creative common especially plays a very important role for copyright protection in digital era. So now let's talk about this topic, which is really very important of concern. So the first question which comes in front of us when we talk about the copyright law is, what is intellectual property? At a broader sense, we should have a basic understanding of intellectual property. Basically, the intellectual property is basically refers to the creation of human ingenuity. Rights related to intellectual property are recognized by law as a subject matter of rights of various intangible or immaterial products and human intelligence and skill. We all know that this is our intellectual assets which we create out of our hard work is being recognized by law and has been given us a special status and recognition in the form of intellectual property. Well, the intangible product of human brain are also very valuable. This is, we should not ignore this. Like land, building, goods, money, belongings. The intellectual asset is called a is made similar to the property or formal property. The status has been given the same as we have a right to our tangible property, tangible products. Tangible property, we have a right over the intangible products also. But intellectual property rights are rights which govern the use of creation of human mind and the work. So let us discuss more about what is this. So as you can see that intellectual property rights are the protection granted for the creators of intellectual property. It includes trademark, copyright. In broader sense, it includes trademark, copyright, patent, industrial designs, plant breeders' right, we can say geographical indication, trade secrets, and many more. And it helps in supporting discoveries, invention, word, phrase, symbols, designs, all are protected under this. So if we talk about individuality about each of this intellectual property, it will take a huge time. But we'll discuss a little bit about each one of them so that we'll have a broad understanding about what is intellectual property right. As far as copyright is concerned, copyright play a very important role as far as the librarians and intellectual, literary and intellectual work is concerned. So the copyright is mainly related to the literary work. So let us discuss more about it. So the question which comes in front of is, intellectual property rights are like other property rights, as I've already explained to you. They allow creators, owners of patent, trademark, copyright work to benefit from their work, own work, or investment in the creation. Well, these rights are outlined in Article 27 of Universal Declaration of Human Rights, which provides a right for the benefit of protection of moral and material interest resulting from authorship of scientific, literary, or artistic products. Or we can say that importance of intellectual property was first recognized in various conventions like Paris Convention for Protection of Industrial Property. Then we have a Bern Convention for the Protection of Literary and Artistic World. Then various World Intellectual Property Organization also created this. So intellectual property are the right given by a person over the creation of their mind. This is what I have explained to you. They usually give the creator exclusive rights over the use of his creation for a certain period. So these rights, which is being recognized by the law, they have a certain period for which they are protected, and later on it will go either in some of the law, IP, intellectual property, some can renew for an indefinite period over some interval of time, but after a certain period, they relinquish and the right goes to the common people for free flow of information in the society, which we call it's in the public domain. So now discuss at a glance, we can say that we have patent, which is related to scientific investment. Then we have a trademark, which basically explains about the logo or the names of a brand of a company. Then we have copyright, which basically deals with the literary artistic work. Then we have a geographical indication. Well, geographical indication means the product which is created by a geographical region that has to be acknowledged and supported. It is in last few years it has been incorporated into it. Like we can see Darjeeling tea. Darjeeling is known for its tea products. So they have been given a geographical indication tax of the Darjeeling tea, that this tea is particularly belongs to this region and it has an international recognition and a GI tax has been given. Then we have an industry design. You can see the design of a bottle. This is an example. So this design of a bottle explains the designs which is created out of industrial product. It is also been recognized by the intellectual property rights, and then they have a trade secrets and many more. So the intellectual property rights has been created way back many years back, and we have various laws governing which we will discuss in my next slides. But government has come up recently about the IPR policies. But the main motive is to create an awareness about the benefit of intellectual property among all sections of the society, to stimulate the creation of growth of intellectual property by understanding relevant measures, to have a strong effective laws with regard to IP right, consistent with integration obligations, to modernize and strengthen IP administration, to catalyze commercialization of IP rights, to strengthen enforcement and adjudicatory mechanisms combating IP violations, and then capacity development for strengthening and expanding human resource institutions for training, research and skill building. This is what the policy has come up. Now we'll discuss about few rights like patent. What is a patent? Patent is basically the exclusive right granted for an invention. This is patent has been granted for scientific inventions, like if you invent any kind of medicine, that can be patented. This is a basically, I say it's an exclusive right because it has been granted for a product or a process. This is the two condition which is important to have a patent. The invention should have come up with a product, and there should be some industrial process and some kind of process being involved in creation of the invention, and it should be new technological solutions to the problem it should provide. Now, another important IPR is trademark, which I have explained to you. Like, trademark is a distinctive sign that defines creation of goods or services produced or provided by individual of the company. It also called some kind of signature marks, some kind of designs also covered into other trademark. Like I explained to you, the Coca-Cola is written in a specific way, which is a signature mark of the cold drink, and that is covered under, registered under the trademark aspects. Now friends, we'll discuss about a very important topic, which is very much pertaining to the library and librarians. Copyright law. Copyright law is basically is a kind of law which is related to the literary and artistic work. So all the literary assets or intellectual assets which is related to the literary work covered under the copyright law. Or we can say the copyright given by the law to the creator of literary, dramatic, musical, artistic work, and producer of cinematographical film, sound recording. Copyright is basically includes the right of reproduction, communication, to the public adaptation and translation. All the work which we are doing, like Sindhya sir was explaining about the preservation policy, archiving, all is covered under the copyright law, and we have to do whatever the preserving of literature as per the copyright norms. But various question arises when we talk about the copyright law. What are the basic characteristics of copyright law which helps the author or the creator in the new digital world? Because everything is digitally driven now, technological driven. So how this copyright, is the copyright compatible with the new technological measures? These are some kind of questions which emerge in front of us when we talk about the digital copyright law. We talk about the rights related to the literary work and how it extend to serve provide interest. But the underlying question which always comes in front of us is whether the integration of open licenses for digital content like Creative Commons can resolve the conflicts surrounding the copyright law in digital era. Let us discuss about it. So this is a broad copyright law. What copyright law covers? Copyright law basically is being created in 1957. The history of copyright law came very early in 15th century when it was for the reproduction of literary work. Copyright law entered into India in 1847 through the enactment during the East India Company regime. According to 1847 enactment, the term copyright was for a lifetime of an author plus 7 years post mortem. But later on in 1914, Indian legislature enacted a new copyright act which extend most portion of the United Kingdom copyright act 1911. Then it was amended several times in 1984, 1992, 1994 and 2012. But in 1957, when we got independence, we came up with our own copyright law, which is called Copyright Act 1957. The 1957 copyright law covers various chapters. It covers 15 chapters, we can say, where the first chapter covers the short title, second cover about the copyright office and copyright board, third chapter covers the what copyright subset means, what kind of rights are being covered under the copyright law. The fourth chapter covers ownership of copyright and right of the owner. Then fifth covers the terms of the copyright, how long the copyright will subset, how long we have a right over the creation of the content. Then we have another chapter about the license by the owner of the copyright. There are various type of licenses which is being covered by the copyright, voluntary licensing, compulsory licensing, various kinds of licenses has been recognized, and for especially for the print content or the cinematographic content. Then registration of copyright society, right of broadcasting, because the copyright law is copyright and neighboring law, it falls. Neighboring laws means copyright is for literary work and neighboring right covers the broadcasting rights of which is related to news, news broadcasting, or you know, audio, video, we can say the radio broadcasting or the TV broadcasting. Then there are chapter 9 discuss very important chapter discuss about the international copyright law, how the international part of a copyright law has been created, which is which helps in harmonization of international copyright law so that there should not be conflict of interest. Then registration, infringement. If somebody infringes the copyright, violates the copyright law, what would be the penalties? And the remedies to the victim. What would be the remedies to the victim? Offenses of infringement in copyright. What kind of offenses are covered under the infringement of the copyright, and where to appeal? What is the first appellant, second appellant? How, if we feel that our right has been infringed, how we can appeal? So this is what has been covered in this. Now we will discuss about what can be protected under Copyright Act. This is important. Chapter 3, Section 13 of Copyright Act states that literary, dramatic work, musical and choreographic work, graphics, sculpture, sound recording, computer program, compilation of work, derivative work and architecture. These kinds of work has been covered under the are the subject matter of the copyright. So what copyright does not protect? This is also important. Facts, copyright does not protect facts. Procedures, process, methods, this is important.
Mute their mic. Echo is coming. Okay, start, madam.
Okay. So, Copyright Act conferred two type of kind of protection, which is very important to know. What is the motive of having a copyright law? The main motive of copyright law is to protect two kinds of rights of an author. First is economic right. Economic right means if I create a literary work or a movie or a choreography, something like that, I have a right of publications. I can publish that right. I can create derivatives of the work. Even I, through the various kind of licensing, I can sell or assign the right to other and to have a monetary benefit out of my creation. To perform and display work publicly, this is my economic right. But with the economic rights, my moral right is attached, which means when I create a suppose I have created a painting, the my name is associated with the painting which I have created, and I have been given a recognition as a painter through the painting. Suppose I sell that painting to somebody else. My economic rights, I have relinquished. I have assigned it the right to somebody else, but my moral right will remain forever. It will not be taken up by any other person. These moral rights are right to paternity and right to integrity. Right to integrity means if somebody wanted to derogate my work of which my name is associated, I have a right to restrict that person to, you know, abuse my integrity. And I will also have a right that and to see that the substantially I am the owner of the copyright. Even I have given assigned the right to somebody else, but my name is associated with that. So I have a right that my original content should not be altered without my permission. So these two rights are really important. Even I have given or sell my economic rights. So there is a very interesting question case in the court about Amarnath Sehgal versus Union of India. I'll just take 1 minute to explain about the case. Mr. Sehgal created a bronze mural in Vigyan Bhavan, and really everybody knows Vigyan Bhavan is a very important place where the various programs happen of government. It was placed on the wall of the lobby of the convention hall and national architecture architect. It becomes the symbol of national architecture and a part of Indian art heritage. But the mural was pulled out in 1979 without taking the consent of Mr. Sehgal. When Mr. Sehgal came to know about the ill treatment of his intellectual work, he made representation to the government authority for restoration of the molar, and he filed a complaint in the court, and the court has recognized his contribution towards the creation of Indian art heritage and a permanent injunction of the defendant to restrain from distorting, mutilating and damaging the Mr. Sehgal's moral, and damage to in return of 15 lakh was given to him. So this is how we have given up our copyright, our moral right remains same. There's another important case, Finch copied 400 telephone directories. The main motive of copyright is to protect the creativity, not the effort. So there is a doctrine in a law called the doctrine of modern of creativity, which means if somebody has given sweat to create somebody, then he has a right over the creation, not somebody has just taken it, done a little efforts, and has not put in any kind of creativity. So he copied 400 telephone directory entries from the rural telephone services of the phone, and the court ruled that rural directory was nothing more than alphabetical list, and it was not copyrightable. So Fisk won the case. Then there is a very important case, which is very important, which is called monkey selfie case, a copyright dispute, where a very important question came in front, whether the human hold, whether the animal has a copyright over the creation, or can non-human also hold the copyright. This is very important case. I will take 1 minute to discuss about this case. In Britain, British photographer David Shelter traveled to Indonesia and took some photographs of critical endangered mesquite. And actually, he put the tripod and he went back to his room by putting the tripod in the jungle. And then some monkeys came in and their steel camera snapped themselves. They took the photograph of themselves in a kind of a selfie, which came up and which was very much, you know, appreciated by the people. He licensed several images to newspaper agencies and mails. The Guardian picked up the story and published a picture describing the photograph as a self-portrait taken by monkey steel camera to snap himself. These kind of things came up in media. But what happened? The Wikimedia Commons and the blog TechDirt posted the image of Slater's objective that he holds the copyright. And even the PETA, the People for Ethical Treatment of Animal, argued that the mesquite should be considered the author assigned to the copyright. They said that the monkey should be given the author or copyright, and it should be given to the ethical the People for the Ethical Treatment of Animal. It was a huge case which took a lot of time. The various kinds of argument came in, but the court had a favor of photographer putting various points, where he put, which I was explaining, that creativity should be there, that only efforts is nothing. So he claimed the photo belongs to the photographer, not the animal. There must be some creativity involved. The photo taken by monkey or the security camera does not count. It has been taken, it has some creativity involved, because the tripod was arranged, the direction was managed by the photographer. So this has been taken into a boom and taken up by people. So this is important to know, that the creativity is really important in order to obtain the copyright. Now we discuss about the public domain and copyright. Public domain, there's a lot of questions. Is the copyright a subset in public domain information? Public domain is a legal doctrine that allows people to use copyrightable material they did not produce. Public domain work can come to be in one of the four ways: work not protected by copyright, some work, even though they are original and effects in the middle, do not qualify the copyright protection. One of the most common example of the work produced by the government. So the government, when they produce some kind of literature, they put it in the public domain, like the judgments of the courts. They are the public domain work. Anybody can take up the judgment, do some creativity into it, and they can sell it, like the database people are doing. Then the second work is expired work. Copyright do not last forever, as I have explained to you. So after a protected period, which is lifetime of the author plus 60 years. This is for the Indian copyright law. After that that period, the copyright work comes to the public domain work. It means that anybody can take out the work and publish it, the work, again in different format. But remember, friends, even the work, copyright work, is expired. But as I explained to you, the moral right of the author, he will remain forever. So we cannot alter the content which has been published by the author, but we can take the work and reproduce it in a different form. So the third is, fourth is, work plays into the public domain by dedication or creative commons. Like if I have created a work, I want to give the work to everybody to have an access. So it is my wish I can choose any kind of license. If it is a digital format, I can choose Creative Commons license and grant to the public or dedicated to the public domain. This is the examples of the work which is available, copyrighted work which are available in public domain. Now we'll discuss about copyright law in digital world. So before that, we'll discuss about libraries and filming. This is really very important concept of copyright law. People think that the information in they are working in the institution, educational institutions, or they are working for literary work, reproduction, they have a fair dealing and they can use the content, they can download the content and use the content anyhow. But there are certain conditions. Under Section 25N, library can make reproduction of copyright material in the following condition. This is the exception under the copyright law, which is given to the libraries about the literary work. Library must be non-commercial. We can take the copies of the copyrighted work in our library only if we fulfill the three conditions. This is important. Library must be of non-commercial. It should be public library or academic library. Reproduction must have been taken within the view of preservation of the material, and library may not make more than three copies of the material if such material is not available in sale in India. Means you have to ensure that the information is not available in sale in India, then only you can keep the copies. Now, we'll discuss about the Indian law for digital protection, digital copyright. As Sir was talking about, Sanjay Sir was talking about the digital right management. Well, this is one of the measures which has been taken up for the protection of literary work in digital platform. DRM provisions were introduced primarily with the objective of facilitation of Indian membership in WIPO copyright treaty, which is called WCT, and WIPO performance and phonograph treaty, which is called WPPT. And various amendment has been made in Copyright Amendment Act 2012 to address the challenge posed by the internet which is called the protecting the technological measures applied by the copyright holders. Well, for digital protection, according to the Indian S publication, for the purpose of copyright means making a work available to public by issue of copies or by communicating the work in the public. This definition, by virtue of its non-restrictiveness, can be construed as covering electronic publishing. So some of the exceptions, such as Section 52, fair deal use of education purpose, which was earlier applicable in relation to certain type of work, like literally, has been made applicable to all kind of work under this. For Copyright Amendment Act 2012, work for digital protection also. So I have explained it to you. For fair dealing, fair deal exception has been extended to the reporting of. I'm talking about for digital content. What Copyright Amendment Act 2012 talk about? Reporting of current event, including the reporting of lecture delivered in public, private personal use, criticism or review, whether of that work or for any work. Clarify that storing of any work of electronic media, including incidental storing, happens sometimes for any computer program which is not an infringing copy, does not constitute infringement. So this is what about the details. Now we'll discuss about Section 65 and 65B. 65A talks about the protection against circumvention of technological measures, which we call the DRM, digital technology, has been framed for the creator of the databases. If somebody intentionally circumvent the technological measures with the intention of infringing right, punishment has been given. Or Section 65B deals with the protection of right management information. Any persons who removes or distribute, copy or broadcast any right management information without authority shall be punishable with infringement. So, dear friends, there are a lot of international treaties like Digital Millennium Copyright Act, copyright treaties, WIPO I have explained, then we have European Union copyright treaty and copyright amendment amendment, Digital Agenda Act, which is Australian. Various cities has been come up with the protection of content in digital environment, and various laws has been created. World Copyright Treaty 1996 came with the motive of protection of work in digital environment. This treaty also deals with two subject matter that shall be protected by copyright, and they are computer programs and compilation of data on material, which is called a database. Then I have explained phonogram treaty came for economic right of distribution, writing, communicating, the performance of public in digital environment. Then I have explained EU CD and DACE came up for European Union and for Australia. So different country has done different work internationally for protection of content in a digital media. But one question arises in front of us when we talk about the digital content and sharing of information. Does sharing content violate copyright law? In some extent, when we share the information, what procedure we adopt for sharing the information? We do linking of the which is quite often, and framing of the digital content. So whenever we do some kind of work, like we are creating a website of the libraries or doing something, we copy that link and share it in our platform. Does it violate copyright law? Or we frame the content, does it violate copyright law? So friends, we all know that linking is a sine qua non for the world wide web. Linking can be defined as connecting one page to another page. Like I have done in my university website, I have linked various sites of different, produced by different government bodies or private NGOs. So I have done linking. So do we need permission to link a site which is publicly accessible? This is a one question. Legalities of linking comes when we talk about the digital copyright or digital protection of the content. What liability is there for the content on a linked site? So according to the WWW consortia, because the act of linking of site does not imply ownership and endorsement. Like we are linking a site, we are not saying if we are not saying that we are owner of the content which we have linked. We do not need to ask permission to link the site that is publicly accessible, because a website owner has given an implied license. So it is also covered under the fair use. Simply placing a surface link is no more an infringement as like library catalog telling stock of books. It is, we can take it in that example. But it could amount to significantly prejudicing if linking of an article or image or someone else blog, if we are doing deep linking, the linking homepage is bypassed and the user goes straight to the link page, bypassing the copyright notice term condition on homepages. And framing may constitute copyright infringement as it alters the appearance of framed website. So if you have question about whether you can or should link somebody, simply ask the content owner whether if you are doing a deep linking, if you are doing straight away putting the home page of the link in your website, it's okay. But indirectly, if you are doing a deep linking, maybe you could be the owner would like it. They are given some sort of disclaimer, and that could amount to issues. So because the web was built for the purpose of enabling hyperlinking capabilities, allowing one site to link to access another. So what exactly can be liability under the copyright law? The problem arises when the practice of deep linking, I have said, defeat website's intention method of navigation. Deep linking may be considered as steal traffic from the link site homepage, thereby decreasing the revenue that could be generated for advertisement that is dependent on the traffic onto the site. So we should be very careful whenever we are doing a deep linking. Straightforward copying the homepage of the link, it doesn't constitute copyright infringement. Now remedies again infringement of copyright. I have explained about DRM. Now we have another important sections before we talk about the remedy is licensing. Licensing is an alternative way for contracting digital content. We all, you friends, you all will be agreeing with me that nowadays, whenever we have to buy e-books or e-content, we have to sign a copyright license. Earlier, the condition was like that. We used to give our terms and conditions to the publisher. Now it has been revised. Now the publishers has give us a lot of licensing conditions in the agreement, and then that we have to follow. What is that called? That is called a binding, legal binding between the two parties. I'll not go much into it, sir. I know, sir, I have limited time. I'll finish within 3 to 5 minutes. Then another important factors of digital content sharing is copyright and creative commons. So copyright assume that people are inherently bad and the law is required to stop it. Copyright is basically people think about is for stopping that. The alternative for digital content is a creative common. Creative common, as I have explained it to you, if I wanted to put my information in digital content, I can choose any of the creative common licenses by allowing or telling the people in a very straightforward manner what I wanted to give it to them, whether I would allow them to use my content, share my content, distribute my content, commercially use the content, or should I want to stop in some condition. For that, creative common has been created. So creative copyright means all right reserved, creative common means some right reserved, and public domain means no right reserved. This is the creative common science. You can see public domain, C cross, then creative common by attribution, by essay attribution share alike, by ND attribution no derivative, by NC attribution no commercial, by NC essay attribution non-commercial share alike, and by NCND attribution non-commercial rights. So in the last, I say the responsibility for new age libraries and the librarians in the digital world. So the digital age present new challenges as a founding for copyright doctrine, that are legal cornerstones of our cyber services. Libraries are a leader in trying to maintain balance of the power between copyright holder and the user in keeping with the fundamental principle outlined in the Constitution. So copyright issues are among most hotly contested issues in the world. Everybody talk about the copyright and digital copyright, especially in the digital scenario, where the digital technology are constantly posing a lot of challenges to the librarians to deal with these technological issues. So copyright law affect the way library provide information to the users, and we should use the fair use doctrine also. This is very, very important, and we should know, the librarians should know the basic copyright law for preservation and replacement, preservation of the information, and library information professional need at least a basic understanding of copyright law and licensing electronic resources which help librarians to ensure copyright compliance within their organization and low copyright infringement. This is really, really important. With this note, I would like to end my presentation, and I would like to thank sir for giving me this opportunity to share this in detail. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Priya. Chairman sir, please request Dr. Akash Singh to deliver his invited talk.
Sinha, first of all, I would express my sincere thanks and gratitude to Dr. P.L. Rai for delivering a very enlightening lecture on copyright and rights. Now, I invite Dr. Akash Singh to please deliver your speech.
Hello, sir, am I audible?
Yes, yes.
Respected Professor Manoj Kumar Sinha, sir, Professor HOD DILS, Dean Academics and Librarian Assam University Silchar, and Professor Samanaha Datta, Dean and HOD Department of Economics, Assam University, Dr. Priya Rai, Madam, Head Justice TPS Chawla Library, NLU Delhi, and Dr. B. Sanjay, Librarian, Tripura University, and Dr. Sumana and Mr. Amit, and all connected participants. First of all, a very good afternoon to all of you. And I extend my special and sincere thanks to Professor Manoj Kumar Sinha, sir, for inviting me for the speak on a topic which is very important in various aspects. My dear friend, today we will discuss about virtual space for scholarly literature and its role, role of open access resources in education and research. Just give me 1 minute, 1 second, so I can be able to share my slide. Whether my slide is visible?
Yes, yes, it is coming.
Okay. Oh, thank you very much. So I just want to express my view that we are now in electronic era, and we are basically living in an era where we cannot go beyond or we cannot live without the ICT and all its impacts and gadgets. And in this COVID-19 lockdown period, we have also experienced a number of things, like we are not going to anywhere in the education institutions, or we can say in any place outside our homes, or because it's the need of the hours to save us and our family members. So all the research, all the things, not only the education and other things, we are getting through online. We are getting all the information through online so that we can do good and we can survive in this situation. So today we are going to discuss about the open access agenda, scholarly research institutions, which are very useful and which have played a very good role, very great role during this lockdown period. And I'm very much sure that all such open access resources will be the future of the education. So today we are going to discuss about the basic understanding of open access movement, and we are also going to discuss about open access publishing, discussion or a preview we will discuss. Apart from that, I will explain or I will discuss about the open access initiative in India. One more thing which is very important in terms of the librarians, or I must say the information managers, that how we can do the open access content management, we will discuss briefly. So first of all, my dear friend, open access movement is not new. Practical way, it was started in around 1966 when Medlar and the Medline process was made available for the research purpose. But the condition was that at that time internet was not there. So due to the lack of the internet, it was available on the computer related file, and the researchers who were doing research on that particular topic and could go at the center where the Medline database was maintained, and open access of these articles can be accessed with the help of that computers. But in a general sense, the open access movement was actually started in 2002 in the paper, when the initiatives and the agendas were adopted. All we know is about the bees, Budapest and the Berlin's and the Bethesda piece. I think it is not required here to explain all the things. But my dear friends, I just want to inform you about two, three more initiatives, which the most of the people they don't know, or they know a little bit, because these are some subject specific. Me and Dr. Priya ma'am, we are doing research in free access to law movement since 2006, and we have published a number of articles and 7 or 8 books on the topic. So basically, first public first open access movement was in law. It was from in 2002, and there was a conference, Law via Internet, and during that conference, Montclair Declaration was accepted, and this declaration was basically taken into consideration for providing free access to all the information generated by the government organizations, or we can say the public institutions, during their ordinary course of work. So at that time, free access to law movement was started, and they have created, till date, they have created around 34 virtual law schools, and most of the countries' legal information we can access from the website of that of these legal institute. India launched its Legal Information Institute in 2010, which was inaugurated by National Law University Delhi in Vigyan Bhavan in 2010. Apart from that, I would also like to discuss about the Dharam Statement of Open Access to Legal Scholarship. Basically, most of the US law schools librarians, they met at a place at Dharam, and they agreed that all the law reviews, means the journals, the scholarships, they will provide free of cost from their website. So this is the need of the hour, and we, the librarians in India, we should take our step further for this. So this is the photo of Dharam Statement of Open Access to Legal Scholarship, which was taken into consideration is 2010. Apart from that, UNESCO initiative policy guidelines is also there, which says that whatever the information is being generated by any organization or any institution, whether it is public or private, where the public money is involved, it should come to the public, because the public money is involved in it. So after that, we are going to discuss about the open publishing. I am just taking care of the time limit, so I am little bit fast. So if anybody has any query, you can send me the email, or you can call me. My WhatsApp number is there in a number of groups. So apart from that, open publishing is also there, to which we should support in a big way. First of all, I must say that in India, around 90% of the research outcome, it generally don't come in the public platform, or even in the people, they don't they are not able to access all the in public the scholarly communication or the research outputs the government, our Indian universities or the research outputs, basically they are giving. So for this, basically we have to take care of that, and we should make aware all our patrons for the publishing models. Like we all know that open access publishing models, several open access publishing models are there. Gold open routes are there, green open routes are there. With the help of that, researchers can visualize their publication. And being a library professional or the information manager, this is our duty to guide all our researchers, faculty members, and the other peoples who are associated with the research work communicate them and to convince them to provide their research in open access. So there are a number of publishing models for open access. We should know about it. Gold open access is there, where some submission money involves, and if the author wants to publish his or her publication in open access, so with the help of any commercial publisher, so we have to he or she has to give few subvention money for that. Apart from that, green OA publishing model is there. Basically, this is the visualizing of the research in the repository of any institution, and this is managed and maintained by the academic or the research institution by themselves. Apart from that, hybrid OA is there. Hybrid open access model is a different type of model, where a publisher, if being a public, being a researcher, I am interested to put my article in open access, so the publishers, they allow us to put our article or the research in public open access with the consideration of small money. And out of 10 or 5 articles, my articles or the researcher articles who is interested to give open access of it, his or her publication, so the single article may be allowed to access apart from the other the closed access people the articles. Apart from that, the bronze open access is all, model is also there. Here the content is free to read and or download on the publisher's website, but it is not openly licensed, and this means it cannot be free shared, and the publisher is able to withdraw access at any time. So this is basically on the discretionary of the publisher. Apart from that, few diamond OA model is also there, black OA model is also there, and two more models are also there. We know is that as Libre model, and one is the gray model. So basically, we have the great responsibility to inform our readers, our users, our faculty members, students, to inform about the how they can visualize their publishing. So why should you party? Why should we should communicate that the researcher should go for the open access? This is a very simple, because nowadays everybody needs his or her article to be cited more for getting more the indexings and all these things. So research for enhancing the quality and the visibility of the research, OA publication is very, very fruitful. Apart from that, the taxpayers, basically they are paying taxes, and with the help of these taxpayers money, the OA, the universities and the other institutions, they are basically running. So for the fruitful result or fruitful availability of all such research, we should basically convince the researchers that their research work should come in the public platform. And now we are looking that now number of countries and the laboratories, they are doing their research in for the COVID-19. So for the social purpose, for the good cause, the research should come in the public platform. And we also know about the Plan S, which is about to implement in European countries, where they are thinking to put all the articles published by the professors and the teachers, professor, teachers and students, in public platform for public use. And they just want to eliminate or remove the commercial wall between the researchers and the scholarships. So a number of open access licensing model is also there if you are going to publish your book. So Creative Commons licenses are there. I am just skipping this because of short of time. And now I am coming to the next agenda, that is the open access initiative. So a number of open access initiatives have been taken by the government bodies and few the non-government organizations. And apart from that, private players and the publishers are also contributing for the for providing open access of their literature in open access. So first of all, being a law librarian, I'm working in a law librarian. I just want to show you that if you want any case from the in case you want to access whether my voice is coming clear, Manoj Kumar sir.
Yes, yes, it is coming.
And my slide is visible?
Yes.
Okay, sir. Thank you very much.
Go
so
ahead.
If you want to access any case of any High Court or Supreme Court of India, or any High Court, or even the District Court of any part of the India, any state or any district, so you can access the text from the four websites available with us. I am showing you. I am just visualizing here. First one is the India Courts. Second word is the Courtnik. In Courtnik, if there is a case is pending with the court and you want to say, you want to see the status, so that Courtnik is very useful. Judis is Judis provide basically the judgment of Supreme Court. Apart from that, IndianKanoon.org, this is maintained by a society which is not related to government, and they spent a good mind, technology and money for maintaining this site. This is the screenshot of the Judis. And apart from the Indian judgments, if somebody is doing research on international or the comparative law or comparative subjects. So the judgments of the other international foreign courts are also available free of cost, like Canada Supreme Court judgments, Australian High Court judgments, UK Supreme Court judgments. And I just want to share with you that the most of the high courts or the supreme courts of national or international courts, they are providing access of their judgments since their inceptions, like UK House of Lords. Basically, this is the highest court of UK before 2009. After 2009, UK has its Supreme Court now. So 1709 onwards, judgment of the UK House of Lords decision can be accessed with the help. Apart from that, the legislative resources are also available free of cost on the websites, like parliamentary debates. If you are doing, I'm just giving one example. If you just want to do research on the education policy, so in this case, you will access the previous education policy. Apart from that, you will also be needing to refer the parliamentary debates which were taken care of at that time when that education policy the previous education policies were taken consideration or approved. So all the resources in the parliamentary debates and the reports and all are very important, not only for law but the social science and the other current form of research. So the all resources are very useful for you. So apart from that, the Constitute is the another database, open access database, where the constitution of any country, mind it, any country around of the world, latest and in the English and their regional language, can be accessed. Apart from that, the legislation of India, the acts we call in India, can be accessed with the help of India Code websites. And apart from the Indian database, Indian acts, the acts implemented by the Australia, Canada, UK, United States can be accessed with the help of their respective websites. So my dear friend, this is I am just giving you the overview of all the websites, because whenever you will go for your research and you want to any comparative type of research, so these website will be in your mind to use. So apart from that, parliamentary law reform reports are also available, like, you know, a number of commission and committees have been set up by the government and the public bodies, so that the social problems and social issues may be discussed. So these type of resources are also available. I am just showing you the things that Australian Law Commission reports, Indian Law Commission reports, Law Commission of UK, and all such reports and all the policy documents are available free of cost. I must share with you that most of the international and the national publisher, what they do, they take the report from their websites and they publish it and they sell it for more than 10 to 15,000 in India. So my dear friends, if whenever you are going to procure a document which contains the reports and anything else related to the government outcome, it is my humble request, first of all, check it in public domain. A number of human rights commissions are also available. Human right commission reports are also available around the world, which are very useful for the research. Apart from that, if you will go for the journals and scholarship sites, a number of sites are there, a number of open access databases are there, from where you can access plentiful of more than millions, billions of articles, research paper, authentic articles, which will be very useful for your research. So like Social Science Research Network, today more than 9.5 lakh articles, research articles, the Social Science Research Network, basically they have, and around 95,000 researchers they have contributed for that. So my dear friends, this is a very good repository of the articles, where you can access most the articles which is useful on a number of subject discipline, which is very useful. Apart from that, Directory of Open Access Journals are there. At today, around 15,000 journals are indexed there, and more than 5 lakh articles you can access with the help of this directory. Apart from that, core is the core basically it's a world's largest collection of open access research papers, and it provides access of more than 24 lakh quality and standard research paper. I know most of the people are thinking that why I'm explaining you, but basically when we go for the research, we feel that we if we are associated with good universities, those have good commercial databases and good access of all the paid databases. So apart from that, if most of the part of the India, you will find not the all universities and colleges, they have good budget and good collection of the commercial databases. So in when there is absence of the money budget and all the implementation of the commercial thing, so these databases are very useful. Apart from that, JURN is the is another open access database which contains more than 300 journals from the humanities and art and humanity databases. So my dear friends, I request you, whenever you do research, or when any researcher comes to do, I request you to kindly inform all the resources to your patrons, students and the faculty members, so that they could be able to exploit all these resources at a very great manner. Apart from that, we also know the Shodh Ganga, it contains more than 270,000 the theses. Apart from the Indian theses, you can also access the theses submitted in UK National Thesis Database with NOIT, eThoys. I request you, whenever you use all these databases, there is a simple process of making register yourself. Please don't feel fear to register yourself, because a number of databases, they give you access only when you register yourself with them. Apart from that, OER Commons are also there, and more than 49,000 plus documents basically can be explained on various subject disciplines with the help of OERs. So apart from that, if you are doing something the comparative things, so international treaties are also available on the website of the Ministry of External Affairs. Apart from that, if you are going to check the treaty or agreements between the other two countries, or anything which is applicable to the all countries drafted by the United Nations, so all these treaty documents and treaty collections are available on United Nations treaties collection. So now we are going to discuss about the scholarship and research in digital repositories. So BPress legal repository, BPress basically it's a commercial platform which collect and which visualize the research output of the academic institution around the world, but most of the research output are available free of cost. I am showing you here the legal part of this BPress depository, where total more than 2,766 quality research paper from law schools are basically maintained for the for further references. Apart from that, Law Archives is also there, where more than 1,028 articles of the legal spheres are available as on May 18, 2019. And if you are not from the law and you are from the other discipline, in this case Open Door ek directory hai is also available which facilitate the access of the number of repositories, and it also provide the search of the repositories on the basis of subjects, and with the help of their indexing you can go to the relevant directory. Apart from that, Registry of Open Access Repository is also there, and basically it has been designed and developed to promote the development of open access by providing timely information about the growth and status of repository. So my dear friends, these are the two search engines through which all the repositories, most of the repositories of the world which are available under open access, can be searched and can be disseminated to their faculty member and students. So now we will discuss about the OA electronic books. So as we were discussing about the gold open access and the diamond open access, a number of publishers are there who are providing their books in under open access, and they whenever an author submit his or her book, they provide they ask them that whether you want to publish your book in open access. In this case, they charge a little bit amount, but being a user, this is very beneficial for us. The standard and the peer reviewed and the processed process with the good processes, the books by these standard publishers are available on their website. So I am showing few numbers of the good publishers whose books are available free of cost. Whenever you go to the website of their of the ebooks of the respective publisher, so in this case you can access these number of books free of cost from their websites. I have mentioned that open access publishing in European network, it provides more than 9,600 ebooks free of cost. So my dear friends, I am very much assured that in India, there would be more than thousands library where the collection will be less than 9,000. But here in open access, if you have the internet and the computer, you can get access, or even you can provide access of these data, these books to your faculty members and the students. So apart from that, the internet archives are there, which provides the access of more than 5 million books, and apart from books, it also provides a number other type of resources. Apart from that, Project Gutenberg is also there, and it provides access of few million books free of cost, and these books are, most of the books are the copyright free. Apart from that, online book page is there, which provides more than 10,000 books, and few databases are also there, like Open Library and the National Academic Press and Digital Books, which provides more than 10 lakhs free books on a number of subjects. Apart from that, Directory of Open Access is also there. Today it provides more than 3,000 books. This data is little bit old. And apart from that, Open Access Publishing in European Network is also there. And Bartley Publication is also there, which provide free access of the book. So my dear friends, we should know the role of the information, we should know the role of the information manager when we develop the open content platform. Basically, we can establish the institutional repository. A number of tools are there, DSpace, Greenstones, and so on. Apart from that, we can promote the Creative Commons licenses, and we can frame the institutional policy for publication so that all the publications and research output involves the public money may come for the general public in open access. Apart from that, we should have the sound knowledge of Creative Commons licenses, and the author, basically they should know about the author ISBN. Initially, around two or three years back, there was a limit about the ISBN, but now being an author, you can apply for your ISBN by yourself, because now this is done totally online. So when you want to publish your book by your own, you need not to go for any publisher. You can apply for the ISBN, and you can put copyright not for the publisher but author. It means the copyright and the ISBN is with you. Apart from that, we all should know the copyright and licensing clauses too. Dr. Priya Rai, madam, has already explained in the previous section. So now I will take only 5 more minutes, and I will explain you about the open access content management. As I have already explained that a number of open access resources are freely available, which we can access and we can exploit for the academic and research purposes. Like open access books are available. I have mentioned around the most useful 10 websites for it. Apart from that, the open access databases or journals I have mentioned. I have also mentioned OERs in India and open institutional repository. So my dear friends, for visualizing all these resources, we can create, we can build our own websites with the help of free web builder tools. I have noticed that now since 6 months or 1 year, a number of library professionals, they have started building their tools for their library, because most of the I must say that librarians, they lack the support from the administration or their institution to create the websites and a number of the ICT implementation things. So my dear friends, a number of tools are available. With the help of you can create your own search engines and the websites for your community, for the rest of the world community. So I have mentioned six tools here. Wix is there, Webs is there, Weblay site 123, Mozilla web and web node, WordPress. So these builder can be used for creating your websites. And I just want to show you one website created by us, me and Dr. Priya Ram, ma'am, for visualizing all the most of the open access resources. So I have we have used the webs.com. So this is the website, basically open access resources.webs.com. We have created. With the help of this websites, you can access the books and monographs, you can access the journal and scholarships, MOOCs and OERs, which I have mentioned, explained in my previous slides. So these are basically the old databases we have indexes in our website, the the databases we have indexed. Apart from that, we have also create an ebook search engine, and all the 10, 15, 20, whatever the number is, the open access sites available on the in the public domain on the internet. So all the sites can be tagged in a single search module with the help of a tool I just want to going to explain you. Apart from that, journal scholarships, all the 10 or 15 the websites you can access from a single click or click to access combined search of journal and scholarship. So this is basically the tool, Google customized search tool. This is a very easy tool. So with the help of this, you can customize, you can create a link through which you can access all the websites available in public domain and for a single click of search. So I am not time is very short, so I just request you all the participants to note the web address of the websites. So because it will take another 10 or 20 minutes, I will go for the live demo. So I just want to conclude with the saying of Thomas L. Friedman: connecting all the knowledge centers on the planet together into a single global network could usher in an amazing era of prosperity and innovation. I just want to read the disclaimer. It's for whatever the photo, screenshot, links or information referred from the open web portals have been included only for academic and non-commercial purposes. Thank you very much. And if you want to catch me, you can catch me at akash@nludelhi.ac.in. Thank you very much. Thank you very much all.
Thank you, Akash.
Thank you, sir.
Nicely presenting your paper.
Nice and thank you
for nicely
presenting your paper.
Now to our chairman, sir.
Yeah. I must express my thanks to Dr. Akash for.
Thank you.
Now, our discussion. Can you hear me? Am I audible? Can you hear me?
A little bit problem, sir, in sound.
Can you hear me, please?
Little bit problem, sir, in sound.
Yeah, they are net.
Now we can hear you, sir.
Now we can hear you, sir.
Okay. So I thank Dr. Akash for delivering a very deep speech. The last speaker of this session is Dr. Anupam Chanda. So I would now request Dr. Anupam Chanda deliver his lecture, and I would further request him to not more than 15 minutes time, because been continuing for hours, 20 minutes. So my request to Anupam Chandu is that you please finish your speech within 15 minutes time. Thank you very much. Dr. Anupam Chandu, please you start your presentation.
Am I audible?
Yes, yes, Anupam. You can yes. start.
Okay, sir, let me share my screen. Is it visible, sir?
It's coming, gradually coming. Yeah, now it is coming.
Okay. Madam Chairman, Professor Manoj Kumar Sinha, sir. Respected Session Chairman, Professor Sumana, sir. Respected Dr. Sumana, madam. And respected all the previous dignitaries, like Dr. Priya, madam, Dr. Sanjay, sir, Dr. Akash Singh. I am Dr. Anupam Chandra, librarian of Assam Dhamgos University. I would like to thank Professor Manoj Kumar Sinha sir, who has given me the opportunity to present my little knowledge, to share my little knowledge in the one with Dr. S.R. Ranganathan online lecture series. So my topic is RFID technology and installation process and in benefits in the library. So what is RFID technology? As we all know, most of us actually aware about the RFID technology. It refers to a technology where a reader captures digital data encoded in RFID text or smart level via radio waves. So it works via radio waves. And then RFID, it belongs to a technology that refers to automatic identification and data capture. That means it automatically identifies the data which is stored in the server. So the RFID system consists of mainly three components. There are so many components, but it mainly consists of three components. That is, one is RFID tag, or we can say smart level, and another is RFID reader, and the end contains an incorporated circuit and an antenna, which are used to communicate data to the RFID reader. The reader then transforms the radio waves to a more operational form of data. Information collected from the tag is then transported through a communication interface to the server, where the data can be stored in a database and evaluated at a later time. So coming to the components of RFID. So these are the components of RFID. First one is RFID tag, which we have to paste it in the books. Inside the books, usually we paste it the last page, that is the back cover of the book. And then second one is RFID anti-theft sticker. So this sticker we have to put on the RFID tags, because it helps if someone try to remove the RFID tags, so they cannot remove the tags. So it will work as an anti-theft sticker. So we can customize the anti-theft sticker. So this is the sticker for my library. We have customized this sticker. I would like to say something about my library, that Assam Don Bosco University Library is the first private university library in entire Northeast India. There are so many libraries in Northeast India which have implemented RFID technology, but all are government institutions. And we are the first private library to implement RFID in our library. So these are the another component, that is RFID smart card. It is very much useful, RFID smart card. Actually, we have printed this card for both library card and the university ID card also. So this RFID smart card works in the library, as whenever the students come to the library for issuing a book, they have to put the RFID smart card in the RFID card reader. Without RFID smart card, their account will not open and we cannot issue the book to them. So it is mandatory to use this RFID smart card while issuing the books in the library. Then this is the RFID multipurpose staff station. Multipurpose means we can take the books and we can also issue and return the books through this RFID multipurpose staff station. Tagging is, while after pasting the RFID tags in the books, we have to activate the RFID tags. So to activate the RFID tags, we have to put the book on this charge station, and through the middleware software, we have to activate the RFID tags, which is pasted in the books. And this is the middleware, RFID middleware software. Through this middleware software, we can activate the RFID tags, we can activate the patron's card, we can issue the books, we can return the books, renew the books, we can check the item details, we can check the card details also. Then this is RFID handheld reader. So it works in two ways. Like, one is for stock verification. In generally, in a library, if you go for stock verification, it will take 15 to 20 days or based on the collection, and maybe more than a month. But with the help of RFID handheld reader, we can easily check the stock verification of 20,000 books within an hour. And likewise, so it will give more than 90% accuracy while verifying the stock. And another use of it is we can search the books through this handheld reader also. And then this is the RFID gate, which is very much important. It is an anti-theft gate also. So if a user without properly issuing books try to take the books from the library, then this RFID gate will beep an alarm. Then we'll understand that yes, the book is not issuing properly, or anyone can take the book without the proper concern of the library staff. So this acts as a security gate of them in the library. So here comes the installation process of RFID technology in the library. So all this information which I have written here is from my personal experience. I have installed RFID in the month of March 2019, just after completion of my PhD on RFID technology. I have implemented in Assam Don Bosco University Library. And these are all my personal experiences, all the information I have written here. So first of all, while going to installation the RFID technology in the libraries, we must collect the information about the RFID system. So for collecting information, you can search various websites, various databases, and various libraries, contact with the librarians for collecting information about RFID, how it works in the library, what are the merits and benefits, what are the components and all these things, what are the costs and all these things. Then the second is visit the RFID implemented library. So whenever you collect the information, it will be theoretical. And when you go to the RFID implemented library, it will be a practical experience for you. So you can compare the theory and compare between the theory and practice. Is it really what I know about the RFID technology? Is it really like this or what? Then compare the merits and demerits of the RFID system. There are various merits of RFID system, and some demerits are also there. So you can compare based on your library infrastructure and your library collection, the merits and demerits will be different. Then contact with the vendor. After comparing the merits and demerits and all these things, you can contact with the vendor. Then ask them to collect the ask them to for the quotation or proposal and collect the quotation. Remember one thing: while asking for quotation, please ask them to mention all the details like the physical verification of the components, like the country of origin and warranty period, AMC, everything. You ask everything in the quotation. Then compare the quotation, and at least three to four quotation, try to collect 3 to 4 quotation from different vendors. Then prepare a comparative sheet of the quotation. Arrange a meeting with the experts. After comparing the quotation, you arrange a meeting with the experts and the higher authorities of the institution, and tell them that this is the thing we are going to install, and give time. If possible, give them a presentation to the higher authorities so that they can also aware about the technology. Then after that, finalize the quotation. Before finalizing the quotation, remember, don't only go for the price while finalizing the quotation. Consider different other things also, like the quality of the components, country of origin. If it is a Chinese made, then quality will not be that much of a high quality. And we are using German made components. And most importantly, where is the vendor's office. If it is a local vendor, that it is a very good for you, because you will be needed local support in sometimes for hardware maintenance. For software maintenance, they will give support through AnyDesk software or through TeamViewer or through remote logging. But for hardware maintenance, we have to contact them anytime. So before finalizing the vendor, you just keep it mind that if the vendor is a local vendor, that it will good for you. Then phase wise selection of RFID components, there are various types of components. So I will recommend you to select the components phase wise, like whichever is important, try to purchase in first phase, like RFID staff station, then modular software, card reader, etc. RFID tags, then anti-theft sticker, which will be in the first phase. These things are important, and in the second phase you can purchase handheld reader security gate, because if you purchase handheld reader security gate in the first phase, then it will be not in use up to if you complete, whenever you complete the all the tagging process, only then your security gate and handheld reader and self-issued and kiosk will be used. So better to purchase in the next phase, so that you will get the 100% 1 year warranty, full time 1 year warranty. Then preparation of purchase order. After all the selection, you can prepare the purchase order. Then design the RFID sticker as per your requirement. We have designed our RFID anti-theft sticker as per your requirement. You can put any type of codes and anything whatever you want to put in your in the sticker. Then installation of modular software and hardware by the vendor. The vendor will install the modular software and hardware for you. Then SIP, that is session initial protocol server configuration for connection modular software with the ILMS. So it will be done by the vendors only. And the SIP to server, they will configure the SIP to server for your Koha, for your ILMS. I am using Koha ILMS. So with the Koha, we have integrated the modular software through this SIP server. Then pasting of RFID tags and stickers on the books and other study materials. So then the task will begin. So you have to paste them after getting, after receiving all the RFID tag and sticker. You have to paste the RFID tags in each book, and on the RFID tags you have to paste the sticker so that anyone cannot remove the RFID tag. So after the tagging of the books, after pasting all the books, or after pasting some books, you can go for tagging of the books and other study materials to RFID multipurpose staff station. So this is the interface of RFID multipurpose staff station, where you can put the book in the RFID multipurpose staff station. And here in the accession number, this is the accession number column. You have to enter the accession number in this column, and then click on the scan. The bibliographic information of the book, which is stored in the ILMS, that is Koha or Solo, whatever ILMS you are using, will be displayed here. And then you have to check whether this the title, branch, institution ID, and all these things are correct or not. And then click on write. All the data will be, you can see all this data here. And the status is armed, that is activated. The RFID tag is activated, and you will be seen the status item tagged successfully. Likewise, you can tag all the books here. And after tagging all the books, we have put a write mark on the books, so that later part it doesn't create confusion that which books we have already tagged and which are not. So this kind of level sign mark we have put it in all the books. And this R is for reference collection. These books are for reference collection. So don't confuse between this R and this symbol. This is the symbol, right symbol for that means these books already been activated through RFID. And then printing and activation of RFID enabled library card. After printing the RFID enabled library card, we have to activate the RFID enabled library card. The process is same. We have to go for patron card and then put the card on the card reader. Put the card on the card reader, and we have to enter the member ID in this place, and then click on show, and then scan all the information like name, address, email ID, institution ID will be displayed here. And after that, match the information with the card. If it is correct, then click on write. Automatically the card will be activated. Then the, after all these things completed, you can go for the circulation through RFID technology. So this is the circulation process. In the circulation process, earlier it was a tagging station, now it is a staff station. So in the middleware software, there are two interfaces. One is tagging station, where we can tag the books and the, activate the books and the ID card. And in the staff station, we can do issue, return, renew, then check the item details, card details, and arm or disarm. These are the facilities available in the staff station. So the circulation process is like that. Whenever you students want to, or a user want to issue a book, he or she needs to bring the books in the circulation section, then put the books in the staff station and put the card on the card reader. And while they put the books and card on the card reader, the staff sitting on the circulation section, he or she needs to click on the scan button. After clicking the scan button, all the information like the username, member ID, institution name, charge item, overdue item, fine item, and the item details, the books put on the this staff station will come appear here. And then we have to check whether this information are correct or not. Initially we have to check, and later part of there is no need to check, because after few days we come to know that all the informations are correct, so no need to check. But initially you have to check all the information. Then just click on the issue, it will automatically issue. So this screen will come, it will show checkout successfully. Likewise, in the time of return, there is no need of put the ID card in the card reader. Only the user need to put their books on the staff station, and the staff present sitting in the circulation section, he or she needs to scan the book and then click on return. It will automatically return check-in successfully. Here in this picture, only one book is showing. So you can check in or check out multiple books at a time based on the rule prescribed by your library in the LMS. So we are giving 5 books for a user, for students. So a student at a time can issue maximum of 5 books at a time. So it will take only 2 to 3 seconds to issue 5 books. So it saves times of the users and as well as the library staffs also. And at the time of return also, same books can be returned. And one more facility at the time of return is 2 or 3 users can return at a time. Suppose one user can take one book, another user can take 2 books, another user can take another 2 books. So all the 5 books can be returned with at a time in the circulation section. But at the time of issue, only one user can issue at a time. So these are the things. So there are some benefits of RFID system for the library. So which I am from my personal experience, I am sharing this information. So RFID system in a library reduce the time needed for circulation duties, since multiple tags can be read at a time. So as I also mentioned this thing, error-free circulation is one of the essential features of RFID system. It will be only possible while you are tagging the books. You have to tag this information, you have to insert the information correctly. Otherwise, error-free circulation will not be possible. So you have to be cautious when you insert the information in the RFID tags. Then petrol self-issue return kiosks can additionally free up staff from the duties in the circulation station. So self-issue return kiosks also can be used in the library, but I am not recommending this self-issue return kiosks for a small library. It can be used by a very big library like NIT, IIT, very big collections like 2 lakh, 3 lakh collection library, they can use self-issue return kiosks. And for a small library like 50,000 collection, no need to use this self-issue return kiosk. Then library staffs may be used more efficiently in other areas, including increasing face-to-face services and increase the number of community programs. Then theft detection is easy, as I already mentioned, that the security gate helps the library to detect the books which is not issued properly and taken by the users. Then stock verification can be done quickly with maximum accuracy. Searching of library materials can easily be done with the help of RFID handheld reader. So few suggestions I have put here. before going to install RFID system in the library, the librarian must check the value of the library materials, that is books, whether these are in good condition or not. It is very important. If the books are in very old and the prices are low, then better not to install RFID system in the library. But if you really want to install RFID, then you need to replace the old books with the new one, preferably with the hardbound books. I'm not talking about the rare books, but all the old books are not rare books. Sometimes the books in the books, old books are not that much useful, and these are very low cost, like 10 rupees, 20 rupees. But one RFID tag cost, and tag with the sticker, it costs up to 25 rupees. So it is. I'm not recommending, suggesting that if the library has a very old collection of books and all these things, and then don't go for RFID implementation. Then check the features and the manufacturing country of RFID components before purchasing. Ask your vendor to give all the details with the quotation, as I already mentioned. Buy high quality tags, because once the tags have been pasted on the books, it cannot easily be replaced. There are many types of RFID tags in the market, so go for high quality tags which can give at least 1 lakh transactions. So there are many low quality tags also. When you purchase the low quality tags with a low cost, like 7 rupees, 10 rupees, and you paste it in the book, after a few months or few years, the tags will not work. Then you have to replace again these tags. So it is a very difficult task and not advisable. So go for a high quality tags and which gives at least 1 lakh transaction. Then paste the RFID tags in the middle of the back cover page of the book, so that RFID staff station or self kiosk reader can easily read the text. Buy the RFID components in two phases. First phase, RFID tags, sticker, staff station, middleware software, and second phase, the smart card reader, RFID security gate, RFID handle reader, which is optional. Go with the vendor who can give you quick services. That is, consult with librarians who has already installed RFID in the library. Quick services means if the vendor is a local vendor, then he can give you quick services. Like if, like you purchase RFID components from a vendor whose office is like in Gujarat or Kerala or Chennai, like this. So whenever you face any problem with the hardware, you have to call them. They will come. It will take 10 to 15 days. You need to give them TA and DA and all these things, and your expenditure will be more. And again, if the, they cannot resolve the hardware problem, they will take the components, and again they will come and they will replace it. So it will take a long, very long time. So better not to go for whose office are not locally available. Then ask them. Sometimes middleware software may not work, and your ILMS may also give problems. So always try to take a backup of your data. It is very important to take the backup of your data. I will recommend you take the backup regularly. That means daily, so that whenever you face the problem, you can restore the backup. Ask the RFID vendor to provide proper training to the library staff, so that they can manage if any problem occurs. So generally the RFID vendors provide the training to the library staffs, but if you want more training, then you can ask for them. They will give you all the training. So this is how we have pasted the text in RFID books, RFID text in the book. So I have a small video I want to show you. Just it is a 2 minutes video. So this is the way we have pasted the RFID text in the book. I'm pasting the sticker on the text. This is the sticker where I'm pasting the sticker on the text, so that no one can remove the text. And we have also maintained the record while taking the book, so that how many books we have and which subject books we have text is recorded in the register. Then this is how we have pasted the text. This is how we have pasted the text in the book. Okay. So this is the process of tagging. Just put the books on the RFID staff multipurpose staff station and enter the accession number. Then type on scan and write. It will automatically activate the RFID tag. So this is the process how we have activated the RFID tag. Enter, then scan, then write. Then it shows text is dynamic successfully activated. So sometimes it gives problem also, so you have to you have to put the books on the RFID staff station, and sometimes it will not appear, so then you need to enter the number again and it will eventually appear. So in this way we have tagged with RFID item that successfully displayed RFID tag. So after that, all the successful tagging, we have put the mark, right mark on the book, so that later part we can recognize that this this book has already been tagged. So otherwise, you have to do check it again and again, and it will consume your more time. So we have almost 29,000 books in the library. And I've completed all the tasks within 2.5 months. Every day I used to tag more than 1,000 books in the library. So this is the RFID card reader. So I'll put put the card on the card reader and activate the card. So the process of activation is just like to activate the book. Just we need to put the card ID number in the activation of table, and then click write and scan. So in this way we have tagged this RFID tag in the book. So thank you all. This was my presentation.
Over to Professor Sunandatta, sir. You may conclude, now, sir.
Professor Sina, can I start?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. You can start.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. You can start.
Okay. Thank you very much. First of all, I would like to wish all the members of the organizing committee participated in this session, all the participants, and also to those who are directly or indirectly associated with this 7-day lecture series. First, I wish them a very good morning, because the session started in the morning, and I wish them a very good afternoon, because we are in the afternoon of the day now. So I'm very happy to get an opportunity part of this 1 week Dr. S.R. Ranganathan online lecture series on research methodology and emerging technology libraries, online teaching, learning, and research. Thanks to Honorable Vice Chancellor Assam University, the patron of this 1 week program, the chairman, convener, and organizing secretary, Professor Manoj Kumar Sinha, and to all members of the organizing committee for inviting me to chair to just say that it has been an excellent experience for me to chair this session and to galaxy of speakers. Who are renowned professionals, area specialists, and academicians. The list of speakers include veterans like Dr. P. Rai, Librarian, National Law University, New Delhi, then Dr. B. Sanjoy, Librarian, Tripura University, then Dr. Akash Singh, Assistant Librarian, NLU, New Delhi, and lastly, Dr. Anupam Chanda, Guwahati, Don Bosco School. So it has been an excellent experience, and I learned a lot from their daily. I must say that all the lectures, all the speakers talked on their respective topics with a great degree of eloquence and persuasiveness, and their lectures are full of academic inputs, which will benefit the participants or those or all listeners, and with this they can think forward to contribute more in the area of digital technology and e-learning. So one thing I have noticed that all the speakers, almost all except Dr. Chanda, because he was very specific on a particular technology, RFID, the other speakers, they echoed, they expressed their concern about the challenges we have been facing in the prevailing COVID-19 pandemic environment to carry forward our teaching, learning, and research works. So in this context, I must say that we have been passing through a very difficult time because of the outbreak of COVID-19 pandemic. And this pandemic actually has already changed our lifestyle. Teachers are now taking classes online, supervising research online, organizing meetings, conferences, workshops online. Even school children are also attending their routine classes, coaching classes online. So this transformation from physical mode of teaching, learning, and research to a digital mode of teaching, learning, and research may create some problem for us in future. Because as a teacher, I believe that teacher teaches with the help of his body, brain, mind, and soul. So, which is not possible to accommodate in a single digital platform, which is not accommodate, not possible to accommodate in a digital campus, canvas, a digital canvas. So this may create problem. Now, COVID-19 pandemic period is an extraordinary spell of our life, which we neither experienced in the past, nor even dreamt of. It has brought radical changes, I agree, in our approach to even humanity, culture, education, economy, etc. We are now in a virtual mode of our existence. Now, if I concentrate my attention on how it has impacted our teaching, learning, and research in higher educational institutions, the following points are pertinent to be mentioned here. While teaching, as I said, that a teacher teaches with the help of his body, brain, mind, and soul. This is because while teaching in the classroom, the most important thing is how does the teacher communicate with his or her students. The teacher communicates through gestures and postures. He communicates, he establishes eyeball-to-eyeball contact with each and every student present in the class. He or she controls his or her voice while delivering lecture on the basis of stress required to drive a point down the brain of the students. The students also reciprocate accordingly. In physical mode of teaching, the teachers control the class environment to teach in an effective manner. These are not possible in online teaching unless and until we are able to create a virtual classroom, which will be a replica of real classroom. So therefore, with the present state of technology in this part of the country, online classes can never be the right substitute of physical mode of teaching, learning, and research. We should have to think about this. In my opinion, in future also, the online mode of teaching, learning, and research will continue, but the offline mode of teaching, learning, and research and the online mode of teaching, learning, and research should be complementary to each other in coming days to make it more effective. Now, changes will be there in our life because life cannot be static. Transformation, change is inevitable in life, and one needs to adapt himself or herself with such changes. We know after, who knows, after 100 years, there may be nothing on earth like physical classroom, physical school buildings, colleges, universities, etc. Every house will be a school, a college, a university. So digital mode of teaching, learning and research should continue as long as possible. A physical mode of teaching, learning and research should also continue as long as possible till we get a technology enabled environment to switch over to digital mode of teaching, learning and research entirely. So in this context, I must say that the speakers, a galaxy of speakers, have spoken on their respective topics. Their deliberation is full of academic quotes, and these become more important. The topics like copyright and IPR, then the digital virtual spaces for scholarly literature, these different digital library services, they have spoken at length, and this will help us to enrich our knowledge in these areas. Now this become more important in view of the fact that the country has recently introduced national education policy. So this national education policy, if we look at this national education policy, we understand that our approach to copyright and IPR issues, more educational studies need serious. The relevance and the importance have increased in the present scenario. A solid plan created through national to encourage multidisciplinary approach to higher education and research. The research activities will start now at graduation level of education, where study would be a degree with research. The emphasis on research would continue in PG level, in master degree level of education. Obviously, the focus and priority area in NEP, National Education Policy 2020, is research to encourage innovative ideas, original works, and ideas to come afloat. And in this context, Dr. Priya Rai, she has pointed out that the main objective of copyright is to encourage and protect creativity. The new education policy is also focused on creativity, to create a generation of young minds with research inclination. They will think new, they will try to introduce new things, they will innovate new things, they will float new, and they need protection, because if they find that their new ideas are stolen by somebody else and they are not getting recognition, they are not getting recognition that is due to them, then they will feel demoralized. So as I told you, that in the perspective of new education policy 2020, the relevance of all these topics, the copyright, the copyright laws, the IPR, the virtual space for scholarly knowledge, open rule of open resources and repositories, and rule of digital library services. These are very important, very pertinent and relevant. I hope that all of you have enjoyed the session very much, and I thank Professor Sinha for organizing, and the other members of the organizing committee for organizing such a valuable lecture series. I will request Professor Sinha to explore the possibility of releasing a print volume containing all the print version of all the lectures delivered by our renowned speakers of this session. With these few words, I take leave from you all, and I also thank you all once again. Thank you very much. Namaskar.
Thank you so much, Professor, for nicely concluding the session. You have spoken on new education policy and impact of COVID on online teaching learning. So very elaborately you have discussed all those. I have, due to time constraint, I want that you should speak on some sampling design and all, but I think time is not there, and now there is a time for question answer session. So I will request Sri Amit Urao, assistant librarian, to see if there are any question in our chat box. You can take a question from there and ask the respective speaker to give answer. After that, you may start vote of thanks. Dr. Amit Urao, please.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Today's session was really very much informative, and now we are at the time to take question answers. But right now in my chat box there are no questions, so I think we should move to the vote of thanks. Is there any question in your chat box, sir?
I have one question, Dr. Akash. You have mentioned author ISBN number, so please explain in detail.
Sir, am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Sir, basically, initially, there was a process to apply for the ISBN number. So, if anybody, any author initially wanted to publish a book, he or she had to approach to the basically the publisher for publishing a thing. But now the thing has changed. When the ISBN authority, they have started online registration of ISBN. So in this case, if you have one Aadhaar card or one more ID with you, so you can apply for the ISBN by yourself too. In this case, now the self-publishing, basically it has also been going to adopt by a number of people. So in this case, the author ISBN is very much used for this purpose. So you need not to go anywhere. You have to go to the ISBN authority website, and you have to create your own login ID, and it will ask you for upload one Aadhaar or one any other identity, and it will ask for the cover page of the book for which you want to claim the ISBN number, and you have to submit a little bit description of your book, the title and other things. And within 1 week or 15 days, you will get one ISBN from your name. So it means that you need not to go for the publisher for claiming any ISBN. So that's why I use the term the author ISBN.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Akash.
Thank you
for all of us. We may publish our own book, and now various platforms are available, Amazon and other open access platform, from where we may get our book published.
Yes.
In our way. Okay, thank you so much for giving this information. If any speaker, any participant have any question, they can unmute their mic and they can ask, or they can write in the chat box. We may take a couple of questions.
Okay, so we are not getting any questions. Then should we move to the vote of thanks?
Okay, now you can offer vote of thanks.
Oh, thank you, sir. Thank you very much. So this is the time that we have reached at the closure of the today's program. So before that, we I'm going to offer formal vote of thanks. So first of all, my sincere thanks goes to the Vice Chancellor, Assam University, Professor Dilip Chandranath, for all his support in this program. And now I would like to thank the coordinator of this program, and also organizing secretary of this program, Professor Manoj Kumar Sinha sir, for his all effort for making this program. Because of him, this program could not be conducted. So thank you very much, sir. And my thanks goes to the assistant, joint organizing secretaries, Dr. Mukut Sharma sir and Dr. Sumna Chakravarti Sharma madam, Deputy Librarian, Assam University. So thank you very much, both of you, for your support in this program. Now my thanks goes to all assistant organizing secretaries, Dr. Apurva Jyoti Majumdar, Mr. Rajesh Rangappa Aldarthi, and Sri Kalol Das Talukdar. So thank you, all of you, for your support in this program. And my thanks goes to the technical team of this program, because from the day one, they are giving all their technical support to this program, without which we were not able to conduct this online program. So thank you very much, Mr. Manjit Singha and Mr. Tushar Manish Sinha, for your technical support. And I thank all the participants from different corners of the country for their participation. So thank you everyone for your wonderful participation. And I also thank the Assam University Authority for allowing us to conduct such a program and providing every possible facility for conducting this program. So thank you everyone, and thank you one and all.
Amita, you have missed the chairman and speaker.
So my sincere thanks go to the our chairman of today's session, Professor Somnath Dutta sir, and he has chaired this today's session, and I thank you very much for your for chairing this session, and also for your introductory speech as well as your valuable support for today's program. So thank you very much, sir. And now it is over to the coordinator of this program for announcing the end of program. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Amit Rao, for offering vote of thanks. From my side, as a convener and chairman of this program, I sincerely offer my thanks to our Honorable Vice Chancellor, sir, Professor Dilip Chandranath, and today's session chairman, Professor Somnath Dutta, sir. All the speakers, Dr. B. Sanjay, Dr. Priya Rai, Dr. Akash Singh, and Dr. Anupam Chanda, for sparing their time and speaking on the valuable topic for all our participants. So your talk really very informative and very interesting in particular area. Especially, I thank Dr. B. Sanjay. He has taken up the services in 21st century digital library services and covering all the libraries, right from school to business, higher educational libraries. Dr. Priya Rai, madam, has taken up IPR and copyright issue, all creative commons and different aspects he has mentioned in detail. So we learn a lot from this presentation. I hope our speaker might have get benefit from this. Dr. Akash Singh has also mentioned regarding the open access movement, open access initiative, open education resources, and various aspects he has discussed in detail. Dr. Anupam Chanda has also discussed a technology which he has implemented in his library, RFID technology. He also completed his PhD on RF technology under my guidance. And this is the real thing, this what he have learned during PhD process, he has implemented in his library. That is why I requested him to share his experience with our audience. So thank you so much to all the speakers, today's chairman, sir, and all the participants and all the committee members for attending this session and making this program a grand success. Thank you so much to all of you. Namaskar.
Thank you, sir, for giving me the opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much, sir.
Welcome.
So, Sinha sir, thank you so much for the invitation.
We will give trouble to you also in future.
Please, definitely anytime, sir. Thank you so much. This was wonderful program. Organized very well. Thank you, sir.
Okay, ma'am. Welcome.
Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you. So we should now log out.
Sure, sir.
Okay. Okay. Bye. Have a good day. Now, participant may log out. Tomorrow, we may have a valedictory program after presentation. Thank you. You may log out now.